Freiburg im Breisgau is a bustling university city. Located in the southwest Schwarzwald region, it is known for its mild climate and beautiful recreational areas. The city was founded by Berthold III, Prince of Zähringen, as a free trade fair city.
John Baptist arrives in Freiburg in 1874. At that time, the city belongs to the Grand Duke of Baden, which just became part of the German Empire established by Otto von Bismarck. These times are not easy for the church. During John's studies here in Freiburg, the state is very active in suppressing the church and containing her influence on society. Bismarck wants to unite the German nation without consideration of the Catholic hierarchy. Later, he softens his attitude, but for now, he is unyielding. It is not easy for students of theology, let alone for those who want to become priests. John Baptist is living a rather modest student life. He is being supported by a scholarship provided by the city of Überlingen near Konstanz. He's very happy to hear that he is also being supported by the church fund for poor students. In order for John to continue his studies, he has to attend geometry classes and pass the final exam. This is the condition that follows him from his high school in Konstanz. But after hard work, he overcomes this obstacle, and now he is free to study those subjects of true interest to him. John achieves excellence in the study of philology and theology. In the report assessing the progress of students, the director writes this: "In a special way, I'd like to draw attention to the theologian of the third course, John Baptist from Gottweil. He exceeds others in piety and humility. He possesses extraordinary linguistic abilities. In external behavior, he appears to be socially awkward. Jordan began to learn more than 50, yes, 50 foreign languages. He already speaks some of them, and most of them, he has learned enough to be able to make translations. At the age of 29, John is attaining what seemed a long-distance dream in Gottweil. His faith and perseverance leads him to attain his university diploma." ¶¶
Munich, Jordan personally meets Father Arnold Jansen, who has just founded the Congregation of the Divine Word Missionaries, or the Verbists. He has opened a missionary house in the Netherlands. After meeting with John, Father Jansen notes, "A student of philology and theology from Baden approached me. He speaks five languages and is learning more. He seems to have a real talent and to be a man of deep and sincere devotion."
After meeting with Jansen, Jordan becomes very enthusiastic about the missions. During his summer holidays, he travels to Belgium and to the Netherlands. All signs seem to support his decision to follow a missionary vocation. But he doesn't join So Jordan goes his own way and sees Rome on the horizon. His summer holidays have ended, and it's time to return to Freiburg. Now, the next step is crucial on his way to the priesthood. To take the step toward completing his path of education, John Baptist of Gertweil must cross the threshold of St. Peter's Seminary. And this is a decisive moment. The high school in Konstanz was a challenging time. The university in Freiburg was an invigorating time. This is the time to prepare for priestly ordination. Failure to achieve this would be a devastating time. Is the one who started as a skilled craftsman and is now an educated theologian be strong enough, smart enough? Will he make it? The many hours spent in prayer in this beautiful Baroque church helps shape the vocation of Jordan, who is on the threshold toward priestly ministry.
Study in St. Peter Seminary was the last year of education, away from the hustle of the city and university life. A small group of a dozen or so students usually had plenty of space, both physical and spiritual, to mature and get ready for the final decision. The lectures concerned practical things necessary in the life of the future priests, including pastoral theology, the practice of hearing confession, the law, public preaching, liturgy, and singing.
John receives good and very good grades in all his subjects. Only in singing is he almost good. So now he is ready, at least theoretically, for pastoral ministry. Professors share their observations of John. Despite his social awkwardness, he's very polite, a little clumsy, very pious, friendly, zealous in vocation, prone to meticulousness, and he works diligently, but is not very practical. It appears he wants to devote himself to the study of languages. But what's happening within him is far more interesting. His spiritual diary reveals this.
First and foremost, and it should always be, is to become, to live and to die as holy and pleasing to God. Anything that does not lead to this goal or bothers you, remove with the help of God's grace. Although you can do many works for good, spend daily with God several hours focused on prayer and meditation. What is harder for a citizen of the earth than the situation when God turns away from him, leaving him alone? His fate is similar to that of an abandoned sailor who wanders on his brittle boat, thrown by wind and storm. The danger surrounding and threatening me makes me cry, "Lord, save me, otherwise I will die." Put aside the unreasonable fear. It does not please God, because God is not a despot. Be concerned about restoring physical health so that you can better serve God and work for his glory and for the salvation of your neighbor. The suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ should be a constant motive for you to willingly suffer with him. Do you want to die in peace? Then work hard to the blood for the glory of God and for the salvation of souls.
These notes portray the image of a man who, on the one hand, is certain of his purpose and vocation, and on the other hand, he is in constant struggle over what God is asking of him. If it were some kind of earthly desire, it would probably be too difficult for him to sustain his motivation and stay on the right path. But there is something bigger here. Trusting in divine providence is key to understand it. His spiritual diary reveals the movement of his opus magnum, the work of his life. He writes emphatically, "Do with God's help what has been planned." During his last year here at St. Peter's Seminary, there is one thought that absorbs him more and more, that he is called to take personal responsibility to start a new apostolic work in the church. Meanwhile, the grand finale is coming. First step, becoming a subdeacon. This is the first time the seminarian proclaims publicly that he is ready and wants to be ordained. The next step, becoming a deacon. The candidate recites this prayer. "Lord Jesus Christ, I, your unworthy servant, intend and decide to accept today the diaconate ordination. Grant me the grace to accept it for your glory, for the salvation of souls, and for eternal life." On July 21st, 1878, John Baptist Jordan receives the sacrament of priesthood through the ministry of Bishop Lothar von Kubel. Truly a sublime moment. Father Jordan wants his priestly ministry to serve in a manner that is kind and grateful to God. He notes this in his spiritual diary. This is the culmination of a long journey. John Baptist Jordan is a priest for God. He made it. But it's only the beginning. As a newly ordained priest, Father John Baptist Jordan prefers to celebrate his first Mass in his hometown of Gertweil. But under the law of the Kulturkampf, he is not allowed. And so he celebrates his first Holy Mass in Dottingen in Switzerland, just across the border. But there is the possibility that he celebrates privately here in this chapel, which is attached to a mansion. Be it here in Gertweil or in Dottingen, Father Jordan begins his priestly ministry. But he doesn't remain here for long.
Rome, the eternal city. It is impossible to ignore it when telling any story related to European civilization. To say that all roads lead to Rome, though today it is no longer the case, still reflects the truth about one of the most significant cities in the world. In the second half of the 19th century, Rome became the capital of United Italy. It was not a period of tranquility. The new state struggled for its political status. At first, it was not obvious that Rome would be a capital. This became a reality only in 1871. Rome was ruled by the Pope, who was still a monarch of the church state. But right after the new state of Italy emerged, the Pope became almost a prisoner in the Vatican. It was only in 1929, when the official concordat between the papacy and the new Italian state was signed, that the Vatican was recognized as an independent state. Church politics had changed, but the position of the Pope was strengthened. The First Vatican Council had just issued the dogma of the Pope's infallibility in matters of faith and morals.
With permission from the Bishop of Freiburg, Father John Baptist arrives in Rome, along with another priest, Father Franz Mutz. They both come for further studies. Both men are becoming well-educated, well-prepared, and well-grounded in Catholic doctrine. No doubt, the expectation is that they will return to serve in their local church. In the meantime, they will reside here, in Campo Santo Teutonico, right beside St. Peter's Basilica.
Originally, this place was a Christian cemetery on the Vatican Hill. Mostly pilgrims and poor people were buried here. Later, the Flemish, together with the Germans, built here a house and a hospital. It became the seat of a religious fraternity. In the 19th century, it was a hostel for German priests studying in Rome.
Father Anton Duval, rector of Campo Santo Teutonico, anticipates the arrival of a newly ordained priest from Germany, Father Franz Mutz. Unfortunately, the communications about the arrival of Father Jordan are late or overlooked. Either way, it is an awkward situation. But we know from the notes of the rector that the unexpected guest is welcomed and supported, primarily because of his extraordinary gift for languages. Father Anton arranges for two tiny bedrooms just above the library. Perfect for Father John. Father Anton Duval is a well-known scientist and archaeologist, highly respected among the teachers and clergy of Rome. Father Anton becomes more and more acquainted with Father John and his apostolic plan. Soon, Father Anton becomes his counselor, protector, and yes, his friend. Ultimately, Father Anton Duval will be a very important person in the life of our hero.
Living in Rome cannot be confined to scientific work alone in libraries or at a desk. The city offers countless attractions and interesting places filled with common history and that of the church. Studying in Rome is not just about books and manuscripts. Numerous temples, places of worship, legends and tales are like living history lessons.
Father Jordan is now living and studying at the center of the Catholic world. He absorbs the environment of the Eternal City. And during his free time, he visits various churches and contemplates at the catacombs. This is not the first time he has been to Rome, but he is still in awe of the history and beauty of all its structures, including this one, the Pantheon. However, John Baptist is not here on holidays. He is here to study. This is the Basilica of Saint Apollinaire, right next to Holy Cross University. In the 1870s and 80s, it is the official seminary of Rome. The Pontifical Institute of Eastern Languages is part of the seminary. Father John is a diligent student. For 15 months, he studies Armenian, Syrian, and Coptic languages. The classes are held in a building in Piazza Nuvona.
Thank you.
Father Jordan is also attending classes to learn Arabic, Greek, and Hebrew. Bishop Lothar of Freiburg, who is a specialist on the Middle East himself, believes that sending this younger priest to Rome for studies is a very good investment, so much so that he is supporting him with yet another scholarship. Among the various professors of the Institute, there are extraordinary teachers and experts on the Middle East. One of them is an Armenian monk and priest who is very supportive of Jordan and is hoping he will soon be ready to be a missionary in Armenia. And Jordan is willing, but his inner commitment is demanding fuller attention on the apostolic work. His primary focus is not just learning languages. His vision is maturing with each moment of enthusiasm and, yes, uncertainty.
At the end of the 18th century, the great French Revolution had issued a death sentence for the Catholic Church. Many of the church representatives were murdered. However, according to the old spiritual law, which says that the death of martyrs is the seed of growth and renewal, the subsequent decades of the revolution awakened new powers among believers. One of the hallmarks of this awakening was the rise of a large number of religious congregations and institutes of various forms of piety in the 19th century. Some of them were eminently apostolic and missionary. The Palatines, Resurrectionists, the Salesians, the Combonians, the Divine Word Missionaries, and many more came to life. The Congregation of Salvatorians also has its place among them.
America, America, let God's will be done in all things. Father Jordan writes this in his spiritual diary. The idea of an apostolic society is not meant for only one nation. It is meant to be international, right from the beginning. And now his thoughts are coming together and his heart is becoming more confident. On December 27th, he writes, "It is your will that I do the work." And a few days later, we read, "Your calling to assemble a congregation is morally certain." Will his mission resonate with the world? Will he find the needed help and support of others? Bishop Lothar of Freiburg is expecting him to return to the diocese and serve. John is now sharing his idea and intention with his fellow classmates, Joseph Prill being one of them. And Joseph responds by saying, "This work has no future. It will not develop. More so, you as the potential founder are not the right person to make this happen." Many of us would find this offensive, but Father John simply says, "Oh yes, to carry out his plans, God often calls the least suited for the task."
The first program of Societas Catholica was created around 1879. Jordan outlined the clear features of the new work. It has to be Roman Catholic and apostolic. It has to gather people guided by the love of God and the love for the soul of one's neighbor. The ultimate goal is to give glory to God by sanctifying yourself and spreading the faith among all the nations of the earth. Future members should take the vows of humility, love, purity, poverty, and obedience. Although the document was focused on men as the members, The final words pointed to a possibility of including also women in the new work. The design of the first emblem was also created. It summed up the entire apostolic concept.
This time he travels much further away. This is not a holiday excursion. This is the continuation of what he has started in Rome.
Hardships of travel itself, it was also necessary to consider the political realities. The Ottoman Empire, which for a long time made the Middle East a part of its territory, had already lost its power. In 1880, Egypt was formally ruled by the Muhammad Ali dynasty, but it was not really an independent state. The British and the French both tried to control the area, mainly because of the Suez Canal, which had opened a few years earlier. The situation was quite tense.
Father Jordan is traveling with Father Ferdinand Borga. On the 29th of January, they arrive in Alexandria, Egypt. Both are truly impressed with their first encounter in the land of the pharaohs. The difference between Europe and the Egyptian Arab world is striking to them. They're welcomed with hospitality and accommodations with the Franciscan community. For the next few days, they become familiar with the traditions of the Eastern Church. They participate in various liturgies celebrated in different local dialects. This exposure to Eastern Christianity is enlightening. He learns about the impact of cultural diversity on faith within the church. He also has the opportunity to meet up with familiar Roman Catholic congregations like the Lazarus, who were founded by Vincent de Paul, and the Christian Brothers. Both serve and minister here in Egypt in the fields of education and medicine. This whole new experience fascinates Jordan as much as Pompey's pillar and Cleopatra's needle, which is still standing in Alexandria at that time. He finally meets with Archbishop Luigi Cercia. apostolic delegate to Egypt and Arabia. This is a mission that was entrusted to him upon his leaving Rome. After a few days, our two travelers move on to Cairo.
Half a million people lived in Cairo. The pyramids, the everlasting hallmark of ancient Egypt, still dominated the left bank of the Nile. But the Arabic language was spoken on the streets, and Arab culture shaped the society of the city. Over 400 mosques, 36 synagogues, and only 12 Christian churches reflected the proportions of the followers of each religion. Cairo was still the second most populated Muslim city in the world, after Istanbul.
Father Jordan admires the various ancient buildings, and he visits inspiring Christian sites. However, the most important visit that he has is with the famous Capuchin missionary, Bishop Lorenzo Masai. The later cardinal has served for more than 35 years in Ethiopia and is ready to retire. Soon, he becomes a strong supporter and protector of Father Jordan's apostolic activity. And in the meantime, they become very good friends.
Palestine was still under Ottoman rule, and the political situation was quite complicated. But it was possible to visit the sites associated with Christianity. In the 1880s, Palestine was home to more than half a million Arabs. Only 25,000 Jews lived there. Among the Arab population, besides Muslims, there were also Christians. Together with the non-Arab representatives of various churches in the Holy Land, they made up a group of about 50,000 followers of Christ.
Jordan and Berga arrive in Palestine late February. At first, they find shelter among the Franciscans, and then they move here to the Austrian hospice, right on the Via Dolorosa. They remain here for almost 7 weeks, and this allows them enough time to become very familiar with the sacred sites of Jerusalem, Bethlehem, and Galilee. The Mount of Olives and the Garden of Gethsemane, just outside the walls of Jerusalem, become very special to Father Jordan. On March 9th, he celebrates the holy sacrifice of the Mass in the chapel of Jesus' agony. He has a very deep spiritual experience, and he writes about how just the Mount of Olives and the Garden of Gethsemane, are my special privileged places for a long time. Father Jordan also has the privilege to celebrate Mass twice at the crucifixion site of Jesus. During one of his visits here at the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, Jordan places his diary on the tomb of Jesus and entrusts his apostolic work to divine providence. He truly believes that God wants this. He just has to trust and not be discouraged when facing painful or overwhelming challenges. Undoubtedly, the time that Jordan spends in the Holy Land, apart from deepening his theological knowledge and perfecting his languages, becomes more like a powerful spiritual experience, like a retreat. And it prepares him for major life decisions that he's going to make very soon.
In the times of the Ottoman Empire, the whole area from Egypt in the west to Mesopotamia in the east was called the province of Syria. Palestine was part of it. In the second half of the 19th century, the various areas of the province gained some administrative autonomy while remaining within the Turkish Empire. The strip of land between the Mediterranean Sea and the mountains separating it from the desert was one of the autonomous regions, Lebanon, ancient Phoenicia, with Beirut as its capital. The name Lebanon has its semantic roots in the Phoenician word for white, like milk. Probably the white was associated with the view of the mountains covered with snow. Lebanon was inhabited by Muslims, Christians, and Druze. Most of the Christians were members of the Maronite Eastern Church. This church was formed here in the 7th century. It is the only Eastern church remaining in full communion with Rome.
Jordan and Borga reach Lebanon in April. Borga stays in Beirut and devotes himself to his studies. Jordan goes to Ein Wartka, a Maronite study center. And there, he absorbs Arabic to the point where he gains recognition from his teachers for his remarkable aptitude for this language. Jordan also finds time to meet with various members of the church hierarchy, both local and from Rome, who reside here. He's anxious to share his apostolic vision with each of them. And his conviction and passion evokes a blessing and support from each of them. Now, a collection of blessings like these is like valuable capital, which he will need for the future development and growth of his apostolic association.
Mountains of Lebanon, famous for their snowy peaks and cedar forests. The main mountain range, with the highest peak at some 10,000 feet, separates the narrow and fertile green belt along the Mediterranean Sea from the Bekaa Valley, which is the extension of the Jordanian tectonic ditch. Further east, there are the Anti-Lebanon Mountains. There is also Mount Hermon, where the River Jordan has its source.
Father Jordan was compelled to go hiking in the mountains for a few days. The beautiful landscape was very conducive to prayer and reflection. It also gave him the opportunity to admire the few cedar trees that were left that once covered these mountain slopes. As he was making his way, something very profound and mystical happened to him, a kind of epiphany. It was a very deep, personal experience that he preferred to keep to himself. Now, there are those that contend that this special moment happened at the tomb of Jesus in Jerusalem. Whatever the external circumstance, this revelation became a confirmation of his apostolic plans. If you will, the seal of approval by the Holy Spirit, the sign that he was waiting for. Father Pancratius Pfeiffer, later to become Superior General of this Apostolic Society, is a confidant of Father Jordan. Pfeiffer writes, "In the mountains of Lebanon, Jordan had the impression that the foundation planned by him would be set up, even if he would not return to Europe himself." Essentially, Jordan believed that this new apostolic work was going to commence and continue, regardless of the fate of the one who is the instrument of God. This conviction gave him the freedom to embrace this mission with unwavering commitment. He is now ready, despite his anxieties and his limitations. And as St. Paul writes, "Press on."
On the way from the Middle East back to Rome, there is Smyrna, today's Izmir in Turkey. and from the time of Saint Polycarp, the disciple of John the Apostle, it has always been the seat of a bishop.
Father Jordan stops in Smyrna to explain the vision of his apostolic society to the local bishop, Andrea Polycarp Timoni. And the bishop gives him his blessing. What's even more significant is that there, Father Jordan writes the guidelines for the society. They're called the Smyrna Texts. He sends the texts to Bishop Masai, along with a travel report and a request for a reference to be given to the Holy Father. Now, the text is written in Latin, and it contains all the important elements, despite the later modifications and edits. And there are three words that fundamentally define the mission of the society: teaching, educating, and instructing. And in this way, Jesus' command is to be fulfilled, to go out into the whole world and to teach all nations, so that every thinking creature may more and more come to know the one true God and Jesus Christ, whom he has sent, to live a holy life and save one's soul. Thank you.